Well, good evening, Place for Worship family, and to our guests, we thank you for joining us on this Wednesday night. I believe it's the last Wednesday of the month of May, as we are continuing to build, to faithfully, intentionally train ourselves in the Word of God, as we are intentionally and passionately going forth in the presence of the Lord in worship. And I know the Lord, He is there right now, right where you are. He is right in your room, right in your heart, right in your life. And He is ready to receive from you the best, the most passionate, the highest praise, and the strongest worship that we can give Him. But today is a new day. Today, we don't want to give God something left over from last week or yesterday, but we want to sing unto the Lord, as the Bible says, a new song. And that is not new lyrics. That's not coming up with a different song every time we sing. But a new song to the Lord is how new I bring it from my heart, how fresh I bring it from my life, because we are still working on living the lyrics to every song that we sing, because we know worship is not just singing. Worship is my lifestyle. So what we want to do as we sing, we want to make sure that we are bringing to the Lord something to sacrifice, because we know and we learn from the life of Abraham that worship demands a sacrifice. Worship demands that I bring something up to the Lord, offer it to Him, and just walk away and trust God to give me strength to look like Him, to live like Him, and to function and operate just like Him. So we are excited right now. I want you to push your excitement button. I want you to be ready to go before the Lord with everything we have, because He is our King. And I can recall from Sunday how we read that scripture that it said, consider all the great things the Lord has done for us. And I was able to go back and read some of the great things that God has done in all of our lives. And so we want to make sure we give Him a great praise, bringing those things to our mind, because we do not worship or praise God on accident. We praise Him on purpose. We praise Him knowing why we are clapping our hands, knowing why we are lifting our voices, knowing why we are singing with joy. We praise God with knowledge, and that's what we're going to do tonight. We're not worshiping Him or praising Him based on what we feel. We're giving Him the glory based upon what we know, and we know our God is good. We know He is King. We know He is Lord. We know He is in control. We know there's nobody like Him in all the earth. We know that our God, He has got us, that He is with us, that He is leading us. So right now, again, stand to your feet, P4W family. Stand to your feet, guests who are with us. Let's make where we are right now the sanctuary of the Lord. Let's stand to our feet now and begin to clap the hands that He gave you, the hands that He wants to hear giving Him praise, the hands that He wants to hear sounding off victory to the enemy, sounding out celebration, no matter what I feel like physically, no matter what may be going on in my life, no matter what struggles or challenges, I'm gonna clap my hands through them, because I'm walking in maturity. I'm praising Him in maturity. I'm worshiping Him in maturity. And I'm not giving God no sadness. I'm giving Him joy tonight. I'm not giving what I go through the victory. I'm giving victory unto the Lord, my God, who is leading me and guiding me and pulling me and strengthening me. So let us lift up our voices in prayer right now. God, we honor You on this Wednesday night. We thank You for bringing us through another day, another night, covering us with Your blood, covering us with that covenant, God, covering us with Your goodness, covering us with Your promises, God. Thank You for strength today, God, strength to be alive, strength to live, strength to give You glory, strength to magnify You, God, strength to praise Your wonderful and matchless and powerful name. No other name, God, on this earth that deserves the praise but Your name. We know there's power in Your name. We know there is victory in your name. We know, God, there is sanity and soundness in your name. We know that demons tremble in your name. We know there's healing in your name. There is peace in your name. And so right now we shout the name Jesus right where we are. We shout your name right in our homes. We shout your name in our car. We shout your name in the living room, in the bedroom, in the dining room. We shout the name Jesus, because in your name there's victory and power. In your name, there's everything that we need. We come tonight in the name above all names. We come tonight in the name of the Holy One, our Christ, our Jesus, our beloved. We honor you. We bless you. And Jesus, we're getting ready to sing to you with everything that we have. We're going to lift our voice to the highest mountain tonight, and we're going to sing from victory in your name, Jesus. Come on, praise for worship. Come on, guests. Clap those hands one more time. Shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph, and let's sing unto the Lord with everything that we have.
Yes, God. Hallelujah.
He's worthy to be praised. Come on, bless the Lord. Oh, yeah. Give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Say it again. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good, and he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good, for he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Come on. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is. Say it again. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy. For he is good. Yes, he is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Yes, he is. He is good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Oh, and he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is worthy, worthy, for he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is good. Yes, he is good. For he is good. Yes, he is good. Last time. He is good. Yes, he is good. Come on, clap those hands if you believe that today. Hallelujah. He's a good God. He's a faithful God. He's an awesome God. Lord, you're worthy of the glory and the honor and the praise, and we bless you and we thank you tonight, God. We give thanks for your goodness, Lord, for new mercies today. God, for your faithfulness towards us, we just want to say thank you, Lord. We just pause for a moment just to set our minds on your goodness. God, just to think about that which is good in our lives that we know has only come from you. So we will not allow what we're going through and the distractions of this life and this world, God, to cause us not to stop and say, thank you, Jesus.
because we recognize how awesome and how great you have been and are in our lives, God. We know that you are busy. You are working in us, God, that you're working through us. We know there's nothing that you can't do. God, there's nothing too hard for you. So we just trust you right now, God, and we worship you. In spite of all, we say thank you, Lord. We give thanks tonight because you're worthy. Hallelujah. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because he's given Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks. Hallelujah. Give thanks. Somebody tell him thank you. Give thanks. Oh, give thanks. Oh God, give thanks. Yes, Lord. I give thanks. Thank you, Jesus. Why? This is how I find my battles. Thank you, Jesus. This is how I find my battles. We give you thanks. Yes, Lord. And this is how I find my battles. I worship you, Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. Thank you, Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Thank you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Oh God, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. And this is how I fight my battles. Thank you, Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. Hands uplifted to him. Oh yes. This is how I fight my battles. Giving him glory, giving him honor. This is how. This is how I fight my battles. Yes, God. Oh yes, this is how I fight my battles in worship. Hallelujah, God. This is how I fight my battles. No matter what it looks like, God, this is how I fight my battles. Yes, God. Woo! It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, oh God. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Thank you, Jesus. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. And this is how I fight my battle. 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 Say, this is how I fight my battle. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. Yes, God. This is how I, woo! This is why. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Thank you, Lord. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. Yes. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. How many of you know that he's not finished with you yet? Say, you're not finished with me. You're not finished with me yet. You're not finished with me. Thank you. You're not finished with me yet. You're not finished with me. Thank you, Lord. You're not finished with me yet. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me yet. You're not finished with me. Thank you, Lord. You're not finished with me yet. You're not finished with me. You're not finished with me yet. So this is how I fight my battles. Thank you, Jesus. Woo. This is how I fight my battles. Hallelujah, I worship you, Jesus. This is how I fight my battles. You're not finished with me, Lord. So this is how I fight my battles. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, this is how I fight my battles. Thank you for strength, oh God. Thank you, Lord. This is how I fight my battles.
Yes.
Oh God, this is how I fight my battles.
Thank fight you, them Jesus. With victory.
Oh yeah.
Fight them with joy.
This is how I fight my battles.
We don't fight to lose.
Thank you, Jesus.
We fight from the place of victory.
This is how I fight my battles.
We fight knowing that Emmanuel,
this is how
God
I fight
is with
my battles.
Us. Fight with joy. Fight in that place called
this
peace.
Because
we already know the outcome.
Thank you, Jesus.
We thank God that he has given
this
us the victory. Don't have to fight to get the victory. We live from victory.
This is how I fight my
so Lord, we thank you tonight for giving us strength, for giving us victory, for giving us power, for giving us your name. God, we honor you. Whether we're on the top of that mountain or whether we are in that valley, God, the environment doesn't change the outcome of the battle. We have the victory, Lord. What a joy it is to get to that place, God, where I learn to be content, where I know how to abase and how to abound. Know how to sing when I'm up, and I know how to sing, God, when I'm down. Know how to magnify you, know how to lift you up. Because we don't want immature worship. We want perfected worship. And it's perfected when it can happen at any time and anywhere, God. We honor you tonight. We bless you tonight. Thank you for surrounding us with your presence, God. Thank you that the angels of the Lord set up camp around those, God, who honor you, who love you, who worship you, who live for you. But God, we declare that you are our only, Lord. You are our only. And we honor you this night in Jesus' name. Thank God for worship. Come on, clap your hands and thank him for being right there where you are. There's joy where you are. There's glory where you are right now. There's power where you are right now. There is peace where you are because Jesus is there where you are. As you worshiped him and praised him, he set up residence right there in your home. Now just let him take over. Because Jesus does not come to follow. He does not present himself just to sit. He comes to take over. And so we thank him for his mighty, mighty presence in your life. And we thank him for another opportunity to continue to build in the word. We want to do just that. And again, we will want to, on a more disturbing note than anything, we want everyone to stay in prayer, just in our nation and the violence that is happening recently there in Minnesota with George Floyd and, of course, with Mr. Aubrey a few weeks ago. Keep their families in prayer. Keep, of course, our nation in prayer. But I'm praying that God will really, that you and I will really continue to grow and be vessels that God can use to bring salvation through us into other lives as they see him shining in us. Because I know it's a statement that maybe doesn't ring strong in us anymore, but the truth is Jesus is the answer. To be able to have him, that brings men and women to a place of peace. To be able to have Christ in our life, it enables us to process things through his name and through the word of God. And that's what will change our nation, what will change individuals, will change men and women from hating and being so fearful, is a relationship with the King. And so I pray that you and I will shine so bright. We allow the life of Christ to come through us, so that the world will see his good works and his greatness in us, and they'll come to know Jesus, and that will make the difference. Amen? So let us jump into 1 Timothy chapter 5. We finished chapter 4 last week in 1 Timothy, as on Wednesday nights. We're faithfully, intentionally training in the word. And we're just walking through whatever book of the Bible God gives us, and we're going through that chapter by chapter, verse by verse, hearing from the Holy Spirit and then building our lives on what he is saying. Again, not hearing 100 messages and our lifestyle looks like we only heard 2 or 3. We want to make sure that we are building, that we are adding, that we're taking what God is giving us and then applying it to our lives every single time we receive and hear the word. So here in the 5th chapter of 1 Timothy chapter 5, again, Paul is giving his son Timothy, his son in ministry, instructions on how to accurately build the church there in Ephesus. As Paul went to Macedonia, left Timothy there in Ephesus and gave him instructions on how to build, how to structure, how to establish order in the church. And we want to take the principles, again, as I shared, from who he is speaking to. As we know, he was addressing bishops at one point. He was addressing deacons at another point. Tonight, we're going to also look at who he is addressing, but I want to make sure that you and I take the principles from what he is sharing to these different groups in the church, because the principles are important for all of us to apply. And so we want to look again, walk through this word in his letter to Timothy, as Timothy is receiving this letter in order to accurately build the church. Because again, church building, if it's not done accurately and if it's not done right, it will crumble and those who are in the church will experience just weakness and just not being sufficient and strong if the church is not built accurately and right. And so that's what we want to focus on as we are watching Paul give Timothy these instructions. So let's begin. 1 Timothy chapter number 5. Here again, Paul is giving Timothy instructions on how to handle different groups in the church. The areas that he addressed are areas where they were having challenges. He's not addressing these areas blindly, but he's addressing them based upon word that got back to him on what is happening there in the church, giving Timothy instructions on how to handle it. So here he says in verse 1 and 2, let's look at that. He begins by addressing older men and women, and he tells Timothy, do not rebuke an older man, but exhort him as a father, younger men as brothers, older women as mothers, younger women as sisters, and do this with all purity. The word rebuke there, when he says do not rebuke, the word rebuke means to speak angrily. It almost like to have an attitude, to be angry. And he's saying here, do not speak angrily to older men. And we're going to see that older in a few verses that they were referring to senior citizens, we would call them. It's interesting. We'll see in a few scriptures that they had an age of 60 and over, and they considered those your elders or your older people in the church. And Paul is telling Timothy, as a young pastor, Timothy, a young man, probably around his 20s, early 20s, he's instructing him, make sure, Timothy, when you and you teach others in the church, when you're addressing older men, do not speak to them angrily. Do not walk up to them with an attitude and begin to speak to them as though you're speaking down to them. And the key is, do not disrespect them when you're communicating to them. He says, do not rebuke them, but rather I want you to exhort them. The word exhort means to encourage them. When you speak to them, encourage them in your language, in your communication. If you're coming to them and you're sharing something that maybe one of them has done wrong, if they made a mistake, again, don't come angrily, but come with the mindset of encouragement when you prepare to speak with them. He says this, treat them as a father, the older men. Treat them as fathers. He said, treat the older women as mothers. Treat the younger women as sisters. And he said, treat the younger men as brothers. What he is saying here, he's putting an emphasis on handle the men and women, handle the young men and young women in church, handle them as family. The emphasis is on family. When he says, talk to them as a father, as a mother, as a sister or brother, the emphasis is on handle your brothers and sisters in Christ as family. In other words, don't handle them as strangers or just a member in the church. Handle them with a greater intimacy in your heart. Handle them at a close distance to you. Do not push them away. Do not come to them any other way than as family. And that's very important, because how we see individuals is how we treat them. And that is how he is talking to Timothy now. He is adjusting his sight on how you see the individuals. See them as family. See them as your father, your mother, your brother and sister. And in seeing them like that, he says, treat them with purity. And that word purity there, it means with respect. Treat them with respect. Honor them with respect. Treat them correctly as you communicate to them. And again, it is carrying the idea that you treat your family right, and that you speak to family right, and that you speak to your parents right. It's carrying that idea. He's already assuming that they do. And so he's saying here that when you go to church and you see your brothers and sisters, your older men and women, that's family. That is family. There ought to be a family approach, a family mindset, a heart that this is my family, my familia. These are those who are close to me. And so I have to come to them with respect, because an accurate family order, you don't speak to your mom or dad with disrespect. In the accurate family order, you don't look at your brother and sister and treat them with disrespect. But the accurate order in the home is, it's always respect of your parents, and you respect your brothers and sisters. And so he said, and you bring that into the church, because again, the church is just an extension of the home. The church is an extension of the home. And so he said, Timothy, there in the church of Ephesus, make sure that when you approach the older men and older women, see them as family. And when you approach those who are your peers, see them as family, handle them and speak to them in that manner. The principle here for you and I is, when we are speaking or handling one another in church, the principle is we are to show the highest level of love, care, and respect to one another. And when we come back from this, you know, this quarantine that we've all been in, when we come back together, let's take this to heart. When we gather again, see one another and handle one another with the highest level of love, with the highest level of respect, and with the highest level of care. When we gather, we don't look at each other just anybody. You don't look at young women that, you know, just some chicks walking in church, and the young men are just some dudes go, no, that's my brother in Christ, that's my sister in Christ, and I treat you with respect. We open doors for you. We honor you. We respect you in that manner. And when we see the older saints, we respect them and we honor them. We don't speak to them any kind of way, is what he's saying in verse 1 and 2. And then in verse 3, he addresses widows. First, he mentions, Timothy, this is how you handle the older saints in the church, and then how you communicate to, you know, brothers and young men and young women in the church. Then in verse 3, he goes and he begins to talk about widows, and he stays on this for a little while. And he says in verse 3, honor widows who are really widows. He says to honor them. Honor real widows. That means to give. That word honor comes from the word honorarium. It means to give financial. It's to give physical and material support to widows. Widows are those women whose husbands have died, and now they're widow. And he's saying here, I want you to honor the real widows who are in the house of God. Give financial, material, and physical support to those who were what? Left with no one to care for them. Because husband is gone now, probably, you know, and kids are grown up, they're gone. And it's addressing the widow, that woman who's home alone with no one left to care. He says, honor. And he's talking to Timothy as, again, the pastor of the church. He's saying, you from the church, you support them. Whether they need finances, support them physically, whatever needs done in the home, around the home, support them materially. If they need something, purchase for them. Take care, he said, of the widows, those who have been left by themselves. He says, Timothy, that is your responsibility as pastor of the church of Ephesus. Take care of those. And again, he pointed out who are really widows. And he has to say that because you always have some shysters out there. You know, you have the real ones, and then you have those who may be widows, but yet they're trying to take advantage of the church or anyone else. And so he says, honor those who are really widows. Then he says in verse number 4, but if any widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show piety at home and to repay their parents. For this is good and acceptable before God. He's saying here to the widow who has children or grandchildren who are still alive, let the children or grandchildren show their what? Devotion to God by taking care of their father or mother. That carries the strength, that devotion to God. That's the piety part where he said, first let them show piety. That is their devotion to God by what? Taking care of that woman who is, or even that man that is a widow. He's saying there, make sure that if there's children or grandchildren who are able, they're in the house. And so again, the instructions had to be specific. He's saying now, if they're left alone, the church takes care of them. But if they have children or grandchildren, he says in that text, that let them show their devotion to God. Again, it's my worship. It is my devotion to the Lord. It is my act to the Lord to take care, he said, of parents, it says in the text, who are widows. He says to, and the word he uses, to repay them. The word repay means not to, you know, give them back all the money they gave you. Repay means to show them that type of service. Give them service. Repay them with service. Whatever you need, whatever I can do, whether it is financially, materially, physically, whatever I can do. If a parent is a widow and you are still alive and you are still well able, grandchildren or children, you take that responsibility, not the church. You take that responsibility to care for that parent who is a widow. And again, if able, the family members, is what he is saying here, should take care of the elder parents and not hand that responsibility over to the church. He says, for this is good and acceptable to the Lord, meaning God is watching us. He is watching the family unit. He is watching how we are operating. He's watching if we have a parent that is a widow and we do not take care of them. If taking care of them is good and acceptable, then not taking care of them is not good and not acceptable before the Lord. So we want to make sure that we're handling that. And the principle here is caring for family is a family responsibility. Caring for our family is a family responsibility first, before it is a church responsibility. Then he says in verse 5 and 6, now she who is really a widow and left alone trusts in God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who lives in pleasure is dead while she lives. Here he defines the widows the church should look to support. Again, now she who is really a widow, and the key word he said, left alone. That is the word that has to be remembered, left alone, because those are the true widows. He says to be left alone is to have no other family member to support them. And all they're doing is looking straight to God for support and for dependence for everything in their life, because family structure has gone now and they are left alone looking only to the Lord. And the Bible says what they do is they just pray and they throw up supplications and intercessions before the Lord day and night, because now they're in a position in life where they are just totally dedicated to praying for others. And they're praying at home. They're praying in the synagogue. It's like they led the ministry of intercession. They were your prayer warriors, these widows, because again, now they're left alone, family's gone, and they had given themselves over to prayer. The principle is here. The widow who uses her life, it says, in the service of God is alive while she lives, but that widow who uses her life to please herself is dead while she lives. In other words, if I give myself over to the Lord, and that's just being a believer, that again, that principle is for all of us. If I give myself over to the Lord, then I'm going to experience life while I live. I'm going to experience the strength. I'm going to experience the joy. I'm going to experience the power. I'm going to experience the authority of the Lord. If I give my life, if I just say, God, I'm giving my life over to you. I'm going to serve you, God. I'm going to walk in your word. I'm going to be obedient. Then God is saying, you will experience my life in you as you live in this world. You're going to experience the passion and the power and the fullness of the life of God every single day. You'll be able to fight through and get through anything because the life of God is in you. You will be able to endure no matter what is facing you. Why? Because the life of God, you won't even know why you're feeling so much strength every day, because God's life is in you. God's life is your motor. God's life is driving you. On the other end, if you live your life to please yourself, it says there in the text, then you will be dead in this life while you are living. And who wants to experience just a void Who wants to experience an emptiness and yet be alive, but yet knowing that I am so empty? I'm alive, but I'm experiencing nothingness. I'm alive, but I'm missing something in my life. Why? Because on the outside, it looks good, but I'm doing everything for me. I'm buying up stuff. And that's what a lot of the women were doing there as Paul was addressing Timothy. They were buying a lot of things and they were looking good. And on the outside, they looked happy, but on the inside, they were empty. And how many people do you even know or have experienced on the outside looking good, but on the inside, there's just emptiness. There's a hole. It's just dark. Why? Because they are the center of their own life. And it's okay. And I want you to understand, it's okay to have what money can buy, as long as you don't lose what money cannot buy. And that what money cannot buy is my joy, my peace, and my happiness. Money cannot buy that. So what we don't want to do while we are enjoying life and able to buy things, that's good and that's okay. We all like that. I just don't want to, in the process of getting things for myself, I don't want to lose what money cannot buy, and I won't do it by keeping my right priorities and the accurate principles before me. And so that's what Paul is saying here. There were women who were widows, but yet they were not giving their lives over to the Lord. And then in verse 7 and 8, and these things command, Paul says, Timothy, command these things. I want you to stand before the people of God there at church and command these things. Why? That they may be blameless. But if anyone does not provide for his own, and especially for those of his household, he has denied the faith and is worse than an unbeliever. That is a bad place to be in. And to be a person where here I am, I'm in the home, but again, my focus is on me and I'm not taking care of my family and my, when I can, not handling my responsibility to help out the parents who are widows when I can. Paul says, you command that they do this. You command everybody take care of your family. In the easy to read version of the Bible, it reads like this. Tell the believers there to take care of their family so that no one can say they are doing wrong. So Timothy, stand there. Tell everybody, take care of your family. Take care of your parents if they're widows, and you have the ability to do that. Therefore, nobody can say anything about you doing wrong in that area. Then he says, whoever is not willing to take care of their own parents, but leaves it up to someone else, or says, oh, I'm gonna just let the church take care of them when you can. He said, that individual, what they have just done, they have denied the faith. That word denied the faith, it means they are contradicting the message of the word of God to do that. That person, he says, is worse than an unbeliever. That's bad. To get to a place to be worse than an unbeliever. The principle here is, don't neglect your own family. To do so is to contradict the word of the Lord. It's to contradict the word that we read and the word that we receive and the word that we speak. It is to contradict, and it's to be worse than an unbeliever, to neglect your own family. That would be husband neglecting wife, wife neglecting a husband, parents neglecting children. If there is neglect in the family to act that way, to neglect them, that is to contradict what God has spoken to us to do and the purpose of him designing the family. And that is worse than an unbeliever, to neglect your own family. Then he gives instructions for widows under 60 years of age. First, he spoke to those who are 60 and over. And now he's talking to those who are 60 and under. The focus here was on younger women whose husbands had died at a young age. So verse 9 and verse 10, it reads, do not let a widow under 60 years old be taken into the number, and not unless she has been the wife of one man, well reported for good works. If she has brought up children, if she has lodged strangers, if she has washed the saints' feet, if she has relieved the afflicted, if she has diligently followed every good work. Here he is saying, he's speaking to the young women now. He opens up with that by when he said, do not let a widow under 60 years old be taken into the number. That phrase, taken into the number, what that means is they had a list of widows in the church. And so they had a list, and it had the names of widows in the church that the church said, we're responsible to take care of them because they have been left alone. And he says these young women are under 60. He says they're not supposed to be on that list. Don't put them down on that list. Young widows who had what? Family support. And they had the opportunity to marry again. He said they're not to be on this list where the church is financially and materially and physically taking care of those widows. Why? Because these young girls whose husbands had passed away, unfortunately, they were not to be put on this list because they still had family support from other family members, and they had the opportunity to marry again versus someone who was, you know, 75, 80, 90, they ain't looking to get married again. So versus the young women who had the opportunity to marry again. Widows on the list had to be 60 years of age or older. And they had to be faithful to their husbands during marriage. They had to have a reputation, the scripture said, of good works. They had to have been able to raise their children, hospitable to strangers, which included the washing of the feet. They had to be women who relieved the hurting and used their lives to do good for others. They were the ones who were on this list. And in reading this, the principle that I grabbed was blessings are a result of your behavior. Blessings are a result of your behavior. It reminded me of scripture that said, if you walk upright, the Lord said, I will hold no good thing from you. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, then God always put it a if before blessing. Salvation, free. Grace, mercy, free. But many of the blessings of the Lord that come after salvation, they come based upon behavior. They come based upon obedience. They come based upon me accurately walking according to the word of the Lord. And the Bible says, if I do that, blessings are coming. The Bible says that those who diligently seek the Lord, they have a reward coming to them. So it's always an act that I do in the word, an act that I do for the Lord, a behavior of mine that brings me into the blessings of the Lord. Then in verse 11 and verse number 12, it reads, but refuse the younger widows, for when they have begun to grow wanton against Christ, they desire to marry, having condemnation because they have cast off their first faith. Again, dealing with the young widows. He said young widows were not to be put on the list who had family support and who at one time desire to be married again. Again, young widows who had family support. And again, the key is who had family support. He said, don't put them on the list because I know what's going to happen. This widow's financial support list had the name of those who had no family support. And these women, what they did was, as we read in the text, they committed to serving the Lord there in the church. They committed into a ministry assignment that we read about of prayer. He said, so here they were, older women. We're going to pray. We're going to lead the intercession group. We committed to doing this. And we know we're not getting remarried. We're just going to serve the Lord in this manner for the rest of our days. He said, don't put the young ladies on that same list. Why? Because they will grow wanton. That means it speaks of young women who will pull away from their commitment in order to fulfill physical needs. In other words, they will get remarried again. And what Paul is saying here, when he used the word condemnation, having condemnation, he said it speaks of the young women feeling guilty of signing up to do certain things for the church, to do certain things that were in the name of the Lord. They would sign up for these things. But Paul said what happened is they would, because they're young, they're and they have physical needs, they would desire to marry again, and that will pull them away from the commitment that they signed up to do. Paul said, I don't want this to happen. I don't want them being condemned. I don't want them feeling guilty for not fulfilling an assignment that they said they were going to do, knowing that they had some physical needs that they would desire to fulfill. The principle here is that God will never, and this is what Paul's desire was. Paul said, I never want to put these young women in a situation that they can't handle and then be guilty for not handling it. And the principle for us is God will never put you in a situation that you could not handle. He will not do it. God will never put you in a place or allow anything in your life to happen that you cannot handle. It's like when Jesus healed the young man that was blind, and this was the young man that he spat on the ground and put dirt upon his eyes. And when he put the dirt on his eyes, I know that dirt irritated that young man. But then Jesus told him to go to the pool and wash. And the boy was irritated because of the mud on the cover of his eyelids and on his eyes. He was irritated. Jesus tells him to go and wash, and you will be healed. And the young boy, he went and washed, and he was healed. What he did was he obeyed what the Lord told him, even though he was irritated, even though something was put upon him that bothered him. And in that place, he still did what the Lord wanted him to do. And that's the principle of the Lord allowing something in my life, that whatever it is, God said, you can still give me 100% service, even though you are going through what you're going through. I wouldn't allow it to happen if it would break you from serving me. I would not allow it to happen if it was something that would keep you from going all out and obeying me. God said that here, I will not put you in a situation that you cannot handle and still give me the best of your service. And that same principle, you and I have to apply. Don't put yourself in a situation that you cannot handle. Do not put yourself in a place where you know if I'm in that position, if I'm in that place, if I'm around that person, I know I will not be able to stand. I know I will not be able to walk in obedience. If you know you can't, don't go there. Don't put yourself in any given situation where you know you will crumble. That is a principle that we have to grab and live by. And then in verse 13, and besides, they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house, and not only idle, but also gossips and busybodies, saying things which they ought not. Now, Paul is saying the younger widows, financially supported by the church, if the church paid for everything for them and took care of them, they would become idle and lazy, Paul said. That's what would happen. They would go from house to house, gossiping and getting into other people's business and saying stuff they should not say. Here we see that there is a connection, as Paul's writing, between idleness and sin. Idleness, laziness, doing nothing. There is a connection between just being idle and that idleness is going to lead to disobedience. Here we see in this also a principle that says, do not financially support someone to commit acts of sin. That is not what we're going to do. We're not going to, Paul said, give money and support these younger widows who we know can do, they can remarry, or they have family members that can help them, but we're not going to give financial support to someone that will use that time instead of serving the Lord. They will use that time to sin. That's what we have to be careful of as believers. There are boundaries to the aid and support you give to others. You just can't give money to everybody. You have to have some type of boundary. You have to have some type of set context in which you support someone. I'm not going to just help somebody and knowing that they're just going to sin, that they're just going to disobey, that they're just going to walk away from the Lord. That's not, we're not helping them in that. As believers, we have we have context. As believers, we have boundaries, and we just cannot just help and in the name of what we think is helping, and actually we're assisting somebody or aiding them in their disobedience. And that's what we do not want to do. Then he says in verse 14, therefore, I desire that the younger widows marry, bear children, manage the house, give no opportunity to the adversary to speak reproachfully. For some have already turned aside after Satan. Still dealing with these young widows, Paul encourages the young widow to marry. Go ahead, get married, have children, take care of the home. And in doing so, the enemy and no one else will be able to put anything on you that would stick. That's what that word reproach, when he says to be able to put something on you and speak reproachfully to you. Reproachfully meaning what they say to you will stick with you because it is true. He's saying, no, young women, don't get idle. Don't go around gossiping. Don't be busybodies. Don't do that. He says, I'm going to make sure that you know you have the liberty. I want you to be sure you know you have the liberty to marry, to bear children, take care of the home. But don't give anyone the opportunity to say something against you that's going to stick. He said, don't do that. And then he said in that same verse, he talked about turning aside after Satan. He said, for some have already turned aside to Satan. In this context of turning aside to Satan, what he was talking about, Paul was saying, in this context, it is listed turning aside to Satan as one of the reasons why women were not able to be put, or widows were not able to be put on the financial list for support, because some were turning aside to Satan. And he said, we're not putting those on the list. There were young widows who had renounced their faith, who had not renounced their faith. They did not renounce their faith, but they began to live and act like Satan, even though they were still in the church. They were acting and behaving in his manner, in the enemy and the devil and Satan's likeness, even though they were still in the church. So they had not renounced the faith, yet they did turn aside, and they began to act and to behave and to practice a lifestyle that was attributed to a lifestyle of the enemy. Somewhere in their pain of losing maybe their young husband, somewhere in that pain, they followed the temptation of Satan. Principle here is you and I must live in such a way, number one, that no one will speak something against you that's able to stick. You have to live in such a way where if they say something against you, it's just going to fall off eventually. You don't even have to fight the thing because it's not true, and it will drop off. But don't let anybody, don't live in such a way, don't behave in such a way where what they say, oh, that is true. No, we want to live in such a way where whatever you say is just going to drop off. Another principle here is in your pain, you fight to stay the course. In your pain, in your struggle, in your hurt, when you are low, when you are really, really feeling down, that's when you rise up and you got to fight to stay the course. You have to rise up with any and everything you have left in you of the Lord, and you fight to stay the course. None of us are beyond acting or turning aside to live and look and act like Satan. Please know that none of us are beyond that. If you allow yourself to give in to the pain, if you allow yourself to give in to the struggle, to give in to the hurt, then you will be a prime candidate to turn and begin to follow and act in the manner and the ways of disobedience and darkness. You have to get to a place where you're able to say, my heart is fixed, oh God, my heart is fixed. And you stand there, you put your anchor down, and you say, tell yourself, my heart is fixed. And when I'm experiencing pain, I'm going to fight to follow and stay the course of the word of the Lord. Turning aside after Satan requires me to turn from God, because you don't just turn and think that I'm not turning away from something. When you turn aside to Satan, that means I'm turning away from God. And to turn away from God is to turn away from goodness, mercy, grace, power, love, provision, everything that God has for us. We cannot turn away from that. And then last, in verse number 16, this is the last verse we'll look at tonight. He says, if any believing man or woman has widows, let them relieve them, and do not let the church be burdened, that it may relieve those who are really widows. Again, he's saying here to the believers who have widows in your family, widows at home, widows that you know of, he's saying here, take care of them. Take care of them. Those widows in your family, take care of them. Don't put that responsibility upon the church so the church can help those who are really in need, who are really left alone, is what Paul was telling Timothy. And the principle here is don't put off your responsibility on the church. And don't blame the church for not doing what you're supposed to do yourself. Because there's a lot of times we'll get to a place again, hurt, and we'll blame the church. Oh, they didn't help. Oh, they didn't do this. Oh, they didn't do that. When that responsibility is upon me, that responsibility is upon me to help my family. It's upon you to help your family. And then it's upon us as individuals to make sure that what I am receiving from church, the word of the Lord, the worship of the Lord, that I am using that to grow. Because some people will, again, point the finger at the church for their own growth, but never open their Bible through the week and never read on their own. And so, again, you and I have a responsibility. I'm responsible for my growth. You're responsible for your growth. I'm responsible for feeding you. You're responsible for eating and receiving and applying that word to your life. So that is God's word to Paul, to Timothy, and those first 16 verses of 1 Timothy chapter 5. Father, thank you for, again, your word and your instruction. As God, again, we just want to take our time, hear your word, pull from your principles of your word, and apply that word to our lives as believers. God, you have a way, you have an order, you have a structure, you have you have principles for us to live by and to build from. And I pray that what you gave us tonight, we will look at our lives, we will be responsible where we are to be responsible, and that God, we will make sure we don't view the church as something that has to take care of everything. But God, we'll take care of what we need to take care of. And through the church, God, you will lead us and use us to take care of what the church is responsible to take care of. Strengthen us, God, in obedience. I pray for those who may be experiencing some struggles and some hurt and some pain now, that they do not give in to that pain. They don't turn after the ways of the enemy. And most of all, they do not renounce the faith in you, God. I pray that we will fight, that we will stand strong, that God, we will trust you to lead and to guide and to know that in everything, God, you are at work. You are there with us. You are building and strengthening, Lord. And every single one of us, we got a testimony of your greatness and of the things that you have done. We bless you on this night. We pass the test. We magnify you. We give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So be it.